My dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, welcome to the Sunday Reach by the Dominicans. In today's readings, we are invited to reflect on eternal life, what it means for us, and our efforts to enter into that life which only God can give us. We are invited to think about our own salvation and what that might mean for us. The first reading of today is taken from the prophet Isaiah chapter 66 verses 18 to 21, which tells us that God comes to save everyone. There is always a discussion about whether all can be saved or some only. But for Jesus, that's not really his concern. He's more concerned about whether you and I will follow him. What if someone does not follow him? That is not really for us to judge. Our concern rather should be to live as he wants us to live, to follow him as he really wants us to follow him. The second reading of today is from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 5 to 7, 11 to 13. And in this reading, we are urged to accept a certain discipline in our living, because such discipline is necessary to follow the Lord. When someone tries to teach us discipline, it's hard for us to accept, because we have to feel the pain, change our attitude or thinking, and be ready to sacrifice certain things that we hold dear to. But the reading tells us to take corrections positively. Because our parents try to instill discipline in us because they love us. Parents cannot be true parents if they do not discipline their children. And the discipline is always painful, but it bears sweet fruit in the future. So is the case in our spiritual life. We cannot be called spiritual persons if we do not have the discipline in our following of Christ. The gospel today, which is taken from Luke chapter 13, verses 22 to 30, Jesus speaks of the same discipline. Jesus tried to put in the minds of the people that the way to heaven is hard and disciplined. People's question was, will all be saved? Who will be saved? For most of us, that means, who will be in heaven? Will you or I be in heaven? But Jesus focused on how we will be saved. The way to salvation is hard and disciplined. There is no easy way to salvation. We live in a time when many people believe that all roads lead to God, that all beliefs are equally valid, that it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you are sincere. But today's readings teach us exactly the opposite. That the road that leads to salvation is one as well as it is narrow, and that we need to make an effort to go through that road and lead a disciplined life. The letter to the Hebrews continues to urge us to accept a certain discipline in our living, because such discipline is necessary to follow the Lord. Strive to enter in by the narrow door. Today's reading, verse 24 says. Elsewhere in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 25, Paul speaks of athletic competition, training intensively in godliness. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, and fighting the good fight. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. While salvation is a gift of God, it is clear that God expects us to cherish it as an athlete cherishes the victor's crown, suggesting that we need an athlete's discipline and determination in pursuing entrance through the narrow door. The door is narrow, and many will seek to enter in and will not be able. Just as we cannot eat a supersized portions and expect to fit into last year's clothing, we cannot expect to be spiritually undisciplined and to make it through the narrow door. The surprise in Jesus' reply is not that access may be limited, but who gains entry? In Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 to 14, Jesus contrasts the narrow gate that leads to life with the wide gate and easy road that leads to destruction. Like physical conditioning, spiritual conditioning requires discipline, and many people are unwilling to pay the price. When once the master of the house has risen up and has shut the door, says verse 25, here note the similarity between these words and the parable of the wise and foolish virgins in Matthew chapter 25, verse 1 to 13. The point is that God gives us a period of time when we can prepare for the kingdom, followed by a time of judgment. Once the door shuts, there is no longer room for preparation or negotiation. It is like taking one seat in a classroom only to hear the professor say, "Take out a sheet of paper and put away your books." Most of us get a sinking feeling when we hear these words because we feel unprepared. A few students, however, will have studied the assigned work and will do well. The point is that when the professor says, "Take out a sheet of paper," the die is cast. We are either ready or not ready. Suddenly, our fate rests in how prepared we are yesterday. Our good intentions don't count. Did we not sit with you at table? Did we not speak in your name? Did we not do our retreats once a year? These really don't count. Consider the real-life parallels to the shutting of the door. For some people, death will come suddenly and without warning. At that point, their eternal future will hinge on their spiritual disciplines and the relationship that they forged with Christ during their lifetimes. But there is another possibility, one that might seem less dramatic, but which can be equally conclusive. We are faced daily with temptation. Our spiritual conditioning, our relationship with Christ can help us to avoid succumbing to such temptations. "We ate and drank with you, and you taught in our streets," says verse 26. Such words are self-indicting. The person who shared a table with Jesus and heard his teaching had every opportunity to become his disciple. In the previous chapter, Jesus warned, "To whomever much is given, of him will much be required. And to whom much was entrusted, of him more will be asked." Chapter 12, verse 48. "I do not know where you come from." Literally, it means, "I do not know you where you come from." Verse 27. Through this gospel, Christ reminds us that the invitation to his feast is open to all. However, each person must struggle to be there. We must do what we have to do by playing our roles well. This is the only way we can be guaranteed a place in the feast of the kingdom of God. And finally, Paul admonishes us to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. This means that we have to put ourselves together by making use of the available opportunity in order to get ourselves prepared at all times. We are therefore called to be focused and disciplined in order to be part of the great gathering of the saints. Amen.